You are listening to a free version of the Majority Report with Sam Steeter. To support this show and get another 15 minutes of daily program, go to majority.fm, please.
The Majority Report with Sam Steeter.
It is Monday, July 1st, 2019. My name is Sam Steeter. This is the five-time award-winning Majority Report. We are broadcasting live steps from the industrially ravaged Gowanus Canal in the heartland of America, downtown Brooklyn, USA. On the program today, Anthony McCann, excuse me, author of A Western Tale of America in Crisis, Shadowlands, Fear and Freedom at the Oregon Standoff. Also on the program today, Trump wilts, may settle for a North Korean nuclear freeze versus a drawdown. Meanwhile, the country we had convinced to do a drawdown has now broken the stockpile limit set by the now-destroyed Iran deal. Federal judge forces the Trump administration to allow doctors to inspect their migrant concentration camps. And new reports suggest that the DHS was warning of riots 2 months ago. Things were so bad. Meanwhile, in the wake of the first and second first debates, Joe Biden drops because of his debate performance and everything else he says. Meanwhile, fundraising numbers in. Buttigieg raises $24 million in Q2. Hong Kong protesters storm Parliament on the anniversary its return to China. And the latest on Lavajato, key witness changed his story multiple times to implicate Lula. Harvard says FU to a generation of kids in Flint, Michigan, and names Rick Snyder as a fellow. To be fair, they just started their new criminal pollution of the environment program. So, and lastly, George Soros teams up with the Koch brothers to do, what do we call those episodes?
Crossovers?
To do a crossover episode in funding an anti-war think tank.
Like Jetsons meet the Flintstones.
Yeah, exactly.
Some good people involved with it so far.
Yeah, I don't know how I feel about that. But all that and more on today's program, ladies and gentlemen. You know, you'd think like a George Soros could just step up and do it himself. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah. I mean, I think if anything, the critique should be, why are there not more, you know, where's Steyer? Like, why are there not more liberal plutocrats willing to oppose interventionism that they have to, you know, do something like this? But I know, like, as an example, like, Tree DeParcy is a big part of it.
Yes.
He's been instrumental in Iran Basevich, efforts.
I've heard.
Basevich. Yes. I mean, we need these people to be funded and working on this.
All I'm saying is, if you're inclined to stop war, which I don't think most billionaires necessarily are, I would imagine a significant portion of them make their money in some fashion or another by war, conflict, the fallout from war or conflict, et cetera, et cetera. If you're inclined to do that, why give the Koch brothers some measure of cover? But to each their own. I know it's intolerant of me to suggest on how someone should pay their, that they should use their billions of dollars for.
Nom, 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 nom.
But that was actually You recorded it from...
I guess I just realized you can hear us laughing over top of it.
We could have had that clean.
He was being very honest.
All right. So, Joe Biden, his polling numbers dropped 5 points in the wake of the poll, according to a Morning Consult. Still in the lead, but under the Cedar theorem of the demise of Joe Biden, postulated months ago that by October, early October, maybe late September, he would be third in the polls, which may be subject to amending in terms of like the fourth in the polls. What we'll see now is that every point in which he drops in the polling begin to create more downward pressure than it would for most candidates, because his biggest selling point is that he can win. And every time he drops in the polls, it is evidence that maybe he can't win. Maybe he's just not that good of a campaigner. Maybe he's not aware of who he's talking to or what his liabilities are. But hold your horses. The debate's not everything. This guy's going to get out there this past weekend, and try and change some minds. Show that he's still sharp as a tack. Here he is. This is at a Chicago rally. What day was this? On Saturday. And he's trying to show that, hey, he's with it. He's hip, man. He knows the score on the street. Listen to him talking about how he understands the plight of Black America.
We need to reform the criminal justice to make sure Black mothers feel confident when they send their child, their son out on the street, that he's going to be safe. We got to recognize that kid wearing a hoodie may very well be the next poet laureate and not a gangbanger. Ladies and gentlemen, there are too many Black men, and I might add women, in prison.
All right. Now, when he says we've got to recognize that the guy in the hoodie may be a poet laureate and not a gangbanger, is he aware that most people recognize that? That the problem, I mean, he's obviously referring to Trayvon Martin, right? I mean, that's where the whole concept of hoodies became a thing. That the problem with Zimmerman killing Trayvon Martin was that he was bigoted and presumed, and there was a lot of people saying, like, you shouldn't be wearing a hoodie, blah, blah, blah. The vast majority of Americans is quite aware that a Black kid in a hoodie is not necessarily a gangbanger. But I would also add that there's also something in between. You don't have to be a poet laureate to be allowed to walk through a gated community. You don't have to be a poet laureate to not have the cops roll up on you. You can just be a dude. You can just be like a guy who's going to be, I don't know, a clerk at a store or a plumber or a doctor or a dancer or a father
or a waiter
or a seller of hoodies. You could be just about anything. His construction is a little convoluted from that segment. But I don't know if the question is like, we want to curb violence, or you shouldn't have to be afraid of the cops abusing you. I think that's the case regardless of what you are. I don't think that all the gangbangers are just gangbangers all the time.
Yeah, like, even if you are a gangbanger, you still have rights, like the right not to be murdered when walking down the street.
Yeah, that's the thing, is I couldn't tell from his construction if he was saying protect them from the cops or protect them from violence or whatever it is. But the bottom line is that Joe Biden thinks he's talking to a nation of racists, and he's the voice of reason.
So in addition to body cameras,
you got to understand, You have these old concepts in your head that if a black kid's wearing a hoodie, that he's a gangbanger.
Meanwhile, I just saw this great showcase of underprivileged kids who go to LaGuardia, and they were reading poetry. That's the Biden plan. In addition to body cameras, before a kid gets drugs planted on him or attacked by some random freak in a housing development, Biden would have a special tactical team trained to check if inside the kid's backpack there's a poetry collection. Oh. And then you could judge the merits of how far that work will get him.
Forgive me, Father. I have sinned. I thought that maybe a black kid could be a poet laureate. I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
Wait, this kid's scribbling poetry.
I mean, this is the type of stuff.
Oh, no poetry. Take him out.
If there's one thing cops have respect for, it's poets.
Yeah, exactly. Hey, hold on, Vic. This kid's got some fucking poetry. Don't slam his head into the concrete.
But the more this that Joe Biden does this type of stuff, he basically shows, like, look, I'm sorry. You're at a rally in Chicago. You're clearly talking about criminal justice reform because you know you have a liability here. So this is your A game. You're bringing out your A game and you're trying to convince people I'm not the guy that I'm being parodied or satirized about. I know this stuff. And I know that just because you wear a hoodie doesn't mean you're a gangbanger, right? Who's with me? I mean,
Ever heard of Saul Williams?
This is a liability that when the chips are down, when he's got to deliver on something, he can't do it because he just has not really opened his eyes. I don't know why. I don't know if it's because he's still the way he was 30 years ago or he's progressed, but he just hasn't progressed that much, or he doesn't realize where the rest of the country is, or I don't know what it is, but it doesn't matter. It matters whether he can deliver on that moment. That's part one. So part one is Joe Biden just showed us in that earlier clip that he is a little bit rusty when it comes to trying to be the vanguard for racial justice in this country. His whole hoodie does not make you a gangbanger, as if it's a revelation to everybody in Chicago. Well, here he is basically doing the same thing when it comes to the LGBTQ community.
I was wondering when he was going to get around to them.
Well, he is at, where was this one? What is this clip from?
A human rights campaign ceremony in September of 2018.
Okay, but which, he just said it the other day, though, too. He said it in Seattle, but we don't have the video of that. Okay, so in Seattle, he gave a quote, which went like this. He said, this was just like, what, a day or two ago, right? He said, you know, if you come here in Seattle, he said, saying 5 years ago, if someone at a business meeting in Seattle made fun of a gay waiter, people would just let it go. This is according to a pool report. The audience vocally responded to the remark, and some of the crowd said, no. In 2014, if people had made gay comments in Seattle.
I don't know about Seattle, buddy.
Well, I'm pretty sure that most of your major cities, in fact, in the country, if somebody had said that. In fact, I think probably all your major cities, if they had said it around a table, someone would have said, you know, really? Like, that was a little anachronistic even 5 years ago. But apparently, he loves this anecdote and will not let it go. He said this a year ago. Now, remember the timeline. 2014 in Seattle, they're doing, business guys are doing gay jokes. Here we go.
You guys have done more to free straight women and men than you have gays and lesbians. And you think I'm kidding. So you don't misunderstand me. Think about this one example. A lot of you are very successful businessmen and women. If you were at a fancy restaurant in Washington 5-6 years ago at an important business meeting, and a gay or lesbian waiter came up, or transgender,
spoke with a lisp or demonstrated they were gay or lesbian. And someone at that luncheon table said, made fun of that person. No one would have said anything. Not a joke. I want you to literally think about this. Today, if that same thing happened, the other four or five people at the table say, you horse's tail, get out of here. Really?
I love that. Horse's tail.
Now,
I'm going to incorporate that.
Now, his point is well taken, but for some reason, he keeps changing the timeline in a very weird way, because apparently in 2014, he told this story, and it was about, and he used it 15 years ago for 1999. So in 2014, he thought that era was over. In 2019, he thinks that era still existed in 2015. The point being is he's got these catchphrases which suggest that he was in the vanguard of something, and he doesn't realize that things have changed, how dramatically things have changed. Exactly. It's like he learned to like pop. You know, like he could do that when, like, we used to, you know, do this thing with the breakdancing, and he learned to pop, and he just assumed, like, I can hang on to this for the rest of time and be the guy on the dance floor who looks like he's really with it. Just to give you an example about what was going on 5 years ago, this was a hidden camera ABC show that they did in Mississippi. In Mississippi! In a restaurant to see how people would react to gay people 5 years ago. Just to give you a sense, Joe Biden is extremely out of touch.
Are you serious?
See?
What did they do?
They're making out. But they're gay.
There's nothing wrong with that.
There's nothing wrong with that.
Are you gay?
No.
Are you gay?
No.
These guys have reached their limit, and now they head off to find their server.
Is there a problem?
Also an actor working for us.
There's that gay couple over there. She keeps calling them out, telling them they need to leave because they're...
But instead of kicking Tracy out, our waiter asks our couple to leave.
Excuse me, guys. I just spoke with my manager. We're going to have to ask you to leave just because of people's religious beliefs.
We have to leave?
Yes.
Whatever.
Let's just go.
Let's go.
This is...
I'm sorry.
He's visibly shaken and upset. Meanwhile, Tracy just keeps pushing.
You understand why I had them kicked out, right?
No, not at all. There's a reason why half the world hates America. And it's people like me. Because you have no acceptance for anything else in the world. I'm so pissed right now.
I know, I can see. I'm not trying to make you mad.
Get out, because there is no point in you sitting here talking to me when I'm the whole...
He was pretty pissed. Now, that is, first of all, obviously a typical example of how intolerant the left is.
She was trying to have an exchange of ideas.
And
I'm gay married.
But he might not even have been on the left. He could just be like,
I know,
a decent...
I'm joking.
He was on the left. He was a socialist.
The point is, Joe Biden, every time he opens his mouth and tries to say something nice and helpful, he's just... out of touch. He has lost sight of where America is. And that is why, in many respects, a lot of people feel like his candidacy is so regressive. You know, look, Joe Biden's very popular in the LGBTQ community because many people give him a lot of credit for marriage equality. And some of that may be warranted. But the fact is that if you're worried about Joe Biden's ability to get elected, this should really bother you. Because, again, like, he could tell this anecdote over and over again. That's all well and good, and that's fine. And like I say, I think that he deserves some credit for marriage equality as much as anybody, at least within the context of the Obama administration, without a doubt. But if this is his wheelhouse, there's a problem.
Yeah, he's like the creepy white family in Get Out, where they're trying to show they're not racist. And the dad's like, I would have voted for a third term for Obama if I could have.
Yeah, it's not even that I think that he's necessary. I think he has more of a problem on race than he does, frankly, on LGBTQ issues. But the issue is that he doesn't know where the country's at. And that is, I think, a big problem for him. But we'll see. We'll see if other people think it is, because I'm not the only one in charge of that, apparently. Hey, just a reminder, a support for today's show comes from the New Yorker. The New Yorker represents the best writing in America today. You can enjoy the works of Emily Nussbaum. She's the television critic for the New Yorker, who in 2016 won the Pulitzer Prize for criticism. You can check out Doreen St. Felix, staff writer at The New Yorker, who covers the highs and lows of today's culture. 2019, she won the Ellie Award for columns and commentary. Or John Cassidy, who covers politics and economics for The New Yorker. All of it, folks. You know The New Yorker. It's the most prominent periodical in the country. Cassie's written articles on topics ranging from the intelligence failures before the Iraqi war to the economics of John Maynard Keynes. Right now, you could head over to newyorker.com. There's a story. Will Hunter Biden jeopardize his father's campaign? John Hickenlooper's war on socialism. Democrats cautiously return to the war on poverty, we see. And then there's stuff about the Democratic primaries moving margins. It's a lot of political stuff. Trump's curious rendezvous with Kim Jong-un. I can only... And then Oregon's tsunami risk, which I did not know about. There's stories on Turkey. The politics are going on in Turkey right now. Robert Caro on LBJ. Matt just literally couldn't help himself. The crossword, you know, New Yorker. Every time we do a New Yorker ad, actually, I have bragging rights with my folks. Finally think that what I'm doing is legitimate. You get 12 weeks for just $6, plus the New Yorker tote bag, weekly home delivery of the print edition, and unlimited access to newyorker.com with 10 to 15 exclusive site-only stories every day. Is when you go to newyorker.com/majority and enter the code majority. You'll be able to access the apps, the online archives, the crossword puzzle, and more. Again, that's newyorker.com/majority. Enter the code majority to save 50% on a 12-week subscription and get the exclusive tote. All right, check that out, folks. We're going to take a quick break. When we come back, Anthony McCann on Shadowlands, Fear and Freedom at the Oregon Standoff. We are back. Sam Cedar on the Majority Report on the phone. It's a pleasure to welcome to the program poet and author Anthony McCann, author of A Western Tale of America in Crisis, Shadowlands, Fear and Freedom at the Oregon Standoff. Of course, this is about the Bundy takeover of the Malheur National Wildlife in 2016. Anthony, welcome to the program.
Thank you. Thank you, Sam. Glad to be here.
So I want to start with this question, and then you know, we'll get into part of the story. The book comes out, I guess it's tomorrow, and so people can check it out.
That's what they say.
And there's a lot of stuff obviously happening in the news that, if not directly related to this in Washington State, certainly, I guess, tangentially so, at least in terms of the spirit of what's going on. But I want to start with asking you about a quote from your book, because you did a tremendous amount of reporting. You covered, obviously, the things that led to the takeover and then the trial itself. But there was one guy who was a part of the Bundyites, a guy named Jason Patrick, who had sort of joined this group as a as sort of a someone who, I guess, was suspicious, not suspicious, maybe, or maybe suspicious, but as a critique of sort of state power in the form of police officers. And at one point, Patrick tried to make common cause with Black Lives Matter, and one of the leaders of the local Don't Shoot organizations, Tressa Rayford, I guess it was.
Don't Shoot Portland.
Yeah.
Tressa Rayford, yeah. She's actually running for mayor of Portland right now.
Oh, is that right? Well, she had said his ideas are who he thinks he is. Will you just talk about that, and then let's go into the story, because I'm just curious as to, like, you know, explain to people what that means.
I'd be glad to. Thank you. That's one of my, for me, that's a real touchstone quote in the whole book for me. And it's such a simple quote, but so complex what Teresa, I think, is saying there about Jason, who is very sincere about his opposition to police militarization and police abuse, and is sincere in his desire to, you know, to ally with Teresa and that cause, and has done a lot of work along those lines, as part of more the libertarian conservative wing of police militarization critique, which has been pretty strong for a long time. But, you know, he's part of also this Bundy circle. And Jason himself, to his credit, was not surprised when Teresa was not interested in aligning with him because of the baggage that his group brings. What I took Teresa's quote as saying, and what she's saying there, I believe, is that it's not enough to live inside the abstractions, right? Your big universal generalizations that underneath all of this is history, with tremendous gravitational and deformative force on persons and bodies and institutions, and that you can't just pretend that you are what you say, and you can't operate as if that's true, because then you will blithely and naively go into situations and just mess things up, right? And in the worst case scenarios, end up just re-perpetuating either symbolically or actually the violence of the past, when you don't actually attend to the work of understanding how, as a human being, we are historical beings. And that means that, you know, we're traversed by a lot of ugliness, and that our ideas, which maybe even our ideas, which maybe on the surface might seem universal and good and beautiful and true, are also traversed by that ugliness.
I mean, I think this is, you know, this describes so much of what I think we talk about, particularly in this era, because so much of it seems, so much of our political moment seems to be, well, is obviously everything is on some level rooted in the past, but so much of it is being brought up in. And maybe it's because of just the sort of like the fire hose of information that we get now, that sort of like historical context and the history that imbues all, you know, positions and policies and opinions are sort of like almost, inaccessible. We can't sort of climb over the huge surge in information. But so much of this lack of historical context, it seems to me, imbues everything right now. And so just, I mean, go a little bit, give us something like a little bit more tangible. I mean, when this guy goes out there and says, like, you know, I've got a problem with the way that the cops treat citizens, like, where, get more specific, because you write that much of what happened with these Bundyites, I guess, you know, harkens back to the failure of Reconstruction.
Yes, for me it does. Yeah. Well, I think that the whole era, to me, I saw, and this is where I think the history comes in and connects also with a huge part of our neoliberal dispensation, which would also be the social media dispensation, and the effect of that on governance, and with also those companies emerging as almost governing structures, all plays into this story too. But the story of the occupation itself, right, I see as deeply connected to that period of Reconstruction, as a form, like when they went out there and they occupied that refuge and they said that they were there to return the land to the rightful owners, right? There's an aspect of that I couldn't help seeing, also with the help of the perspective of the Burns Paiute tribe, which saw it this way immediately, as a kind of Wild West show and a kind of reenactment of settlement, of violent settlement of the West. It's not how those people saw it. Or they did, the part of it that they wanted to see was, you know, the heroic homesteader era minus all the horror, right? So they're restaging this basically claiming of the land to distribute it to the people and make everyone free, the whole frontier myth. But they're doing it in this both messianic way, full of all this religious content, and they're doing it as a, you know, live streaming it on Facebook, right? So you have like both the, and they're also talking in all these registers of our present in all this very familiar conservative and reactionary talk about overreach and federal tyranny and all this stuff. So the past and the present were mingled together in the kind of images that they were sending out from there. But the past that they were particularly channeling, often with total ignorance, they didn't know that the land had been particularly important native land and is held to be very sacred native land, though in a lot of ways, you know, we're talking about like the center of all the water in a very dry region. It's pretty obvious that that would have been the center of all human endeavor for thousands of years. So that history, that particular period that they're reenacting, is in that part of Oregon, really comes to a head with the failure of Reconstruction. In 1876, you have the election of Rutherford B. Hayes, who was a Republican from the Republican Party, but it was one of the most controversial elections that we've ever had. And the compromise that brought him into office basically finally like brought Reconstruction to an end, including the removal of federal troops from the South and a reorientation of the country towards sort of a unifying white priority in settlement of the West, including the removal of more troops into the West for pacification, quote unquote. And that the immediate result of that was one very famous and one less famous wars against Native populations in Oregon that happened to be led by General Howard, who was the head of the Freedmen's Bureau, which was dissolved with the failure of Reconstruction, or before actually, who happened to be the general in charge of displacing the Nez Perce in 1877, the first year of Howard's term. In 1878, they came to the land exactly where the whole Oregon occupation took place and displaced the Paiute people, who then emerged in this story of Ammon Bundy when he claimed that he was like taking this land to give it back to the rightful owners. They were the people that had been displaced first by white settlers and then finally by military force with the change in orientation of the country that came with the end of Reconstruction. At the same time, the Bundys, a lot of the rhetoric of the Bundys, often again unbeknownst to them, bears the mark of that time period. One of their favorite theories is the constitutional sheriff theory, which they tried to work at Bundy Ranch and also in Oregon when they were trying to get the sheriff, which of course he refused, Sheriff Dave Ward of Harney County, to shelter the two ranchers who were at the center of the whole conflama that the occupation bloomed out of, from being returned to federal prison, because according to that milieu, the Bundyite milieu and a lot of the militia milieu, the sheriff is the highest law enforcement officer in the land, higher than the Supreme Court. But this idea has a whole history going back to all the way back to Jim Crow laundered through, or it comes through some of the most vile sort of white supremacist anti-civil rights organizations of the 1960s, the Posse Comitatus, which a lot of these guys don't seem to know it comes from there, but that's where that idea comes from. And the Posse Comitatus is named after the act that ended the use of military force in the South during Reconstruction. Okay. Sorry for that long.
There's a lot to unpack there, and I should remind people that at one point, Governor LaPage of Maine met with some of these sovereign citizens who had this theory that he could contact the sheriffs and have them arrest the lawmakers who were bucking LaPage. And there was a big story about how LaPage's lawyers waited till they got out of the room and had to basically talk him down and tell him, no, this is all bunk. I mean, it's hilarious and it's also horrific. But all right. So,
yes.
So now, just to be clear, the Bundyites, were they looking to return this land to the Paiute?
They were not.
Right. But that was the irony.
Yeah, they were not.
Right. Okay.
Yeah. And the Paiute were able to intervene in that very adroitly, very quickly, very early on in the occupation. They held a press conference, and the area was saturated with press then, so they got a lot of attendance. And they were like, they basically came out and were like, well, that's interesting that they're talking about the rightful owners, and used it as a platform to give their history. I mean, because their history is little known, but
all right. Well, so okay.
Pretty big story.
Yes, and that was I don't know if there's any dynamic that can show the sort of the nature of, particularly from my experience, the libertarian strand in this type of movements, where the date of the original inhabitors is rather arbitrary. And I would say rather arbitrary is, I think, maybe being generous. It tends to be when the first white person took ownership of something is when property rights essentially start, according to them. But be that as it may, tell us just, so let's back up. How, I think people remember the Bundy Ranch standoff, but just remind us of that, and then tell us how it ended up. Why did they go to Oregon? Like, how did we end up with, this part of the story?
Well, so 2014 was the showdown at the Bundy Ranch over the federal grazing land of the Bundy family on their ranch in the eastern part of Clark County, Nevada, out in the Mojave Desert. But Clark County is also where Las Vegas is. And that whole story, Las Vegas is actually very involved in it, but that gets forgotten because it goes back over 20 years. And there's a whole issue there with the protection of the desert tortoise, which was declared an endangered species in the early 90s. This caused a problem immediately because Vegas, as it often is, was in a mega growth spurt. And this threatened to halt the growth of Vegas. And so a lot of money was invested in that. And somehow a deal was negotiated that basically the county was able to count these rural desert areas in its eastern extremities as a special desert tortoise protection zone. And that included new BLM, Bureau of Land Management regulations on the grazing of the ranchers who were out there, which meant they had to move their cattle during, say, the spring green up when the tortoises come out of the holes and eat, and they could run less cattle. And this put a lot of financial pressure on those ranchers. Actually, all of them, except for Clive and Bundy, in the end went out of business. Clive and Bundy came up with another solution. He looked in the Constitution and reading as he's a very devout Latter-day Saint from a very super conservative mindset. So reading the Constitution theologically, as he tends to do, he found a magical clause in there which told him that the federal government had no right to own land. And so he stopped recognizing the federal government's authority in the state of Nevada. And it played out in the court for 20 years. And finally, after back and forth, the BLM came to confiscate his cattle for having been on the land grazing without permission or without him paying his fees. And because Ammon Bundy, his son, who led the standoff in Oregon, in a little kerfuffle with BLM police after his aunt was thrown to the ground by one of them, was himself tased a few times. And then that video went viral in sort of the Patriot militia milieu, and due to some logistical work by a young militiaman from Montana, disaffected Iraq war veteran who had been trying to organize all these dispersed militia groups to come to, you know, the defense of the people against federal overreach and constitutional, you know, abuses, was able to put out those images, and people came from all over with their guns. And very quickly, the BLM decided the situation was too dangerous, and they withdrew. And then 2 years later, that situation was still exactly as it was. Ammon had moved to Boise, Idaho, and a case happening in Harney County came to his attention involving a ranching family that he really identified with.
Why did he move to Idaho? I mean, they were looking for bigger sky or what?
He told me that part of it was they were looking to move. It sounds like, you know, they just wanted to kind of get away from all that conflama. He was living, I think, near Phoenix at that point. He's actually not a rancher, Ammon. He runs a truck fleet maintenance business. And I think he can do that remotely. So they were looking around the West, and he claimed that actually, you know, he and his wife and family came to this place, Emmett, Idaho, outside of Boise. And, you know, that, you know, everything Ammon does is, you know, guided by the Holy Spirit. So he had a place moment there, and he moved to Idaho. And now he believes like that coincidence has to be meaningful, because that brought him within 3 hours of Harney County, which is actually otherwise near nowhere. It's the place with the point in the continental United States that's the furthest from an interstate, but he ended up moving within 3 hours of there. And then, you know, he said that he was moved by the Holy Spirit, or in the way that he figures it, to research this Ammon story about this family that was being resentenced due to this case about a longstanding dispute about management of, you know, federal grazing lands, was being returned to prison. And he felt moved to go there and then begin this whole process of calling these same people who had defended his family in Nevada to come and pressure the sheriff to shelter this Ammon family. When the Ammon family rejected this help and the sheriff, you know, rejected these constitutional sheriff arguments, they took it to another step and occupied the refuge, and then declared that they were first returning.
Well, two things. First is, and maybe this is just because I like the way that my mind works and I'm a little bit obnoxious. Did you say to him, like, how do you justify like having a whole business based upon a federal highway system if the guy's doing the trucking? Well, that would have been my first question of him. But I imagine you didn't want to.
Their take on that stuff, you know, when Ammon gets hit with those lines of questioning, which he does a lot, his take is that, you know, there are certain things that the federal government should do.
Okay.
And roads is one of them. The post office is one of them. His father will be like, weights and measures. He likes to talk about weights and measures, that, you know, a pound needs to be a pound in New York and Nevada, you know, so we can do our commerce.
Okay.
So that would be his response to something like that.
But protecting the environment, not one of those things.
Absolutely not. Right. And that definitely where it falls into, like, also like the political theology of their particular Mormonism. You know, they definitely, for them, this is an earthly sojourn. You know, human beings aren't from the earth. The earth is here as part of like a test. And you have to pass that test. And so the earth itself is here under human dominion to be used as part of that test. So preserving aspects of our earth, not for our use, doesn't make sense to them, because the earth is wholly for our use. Right.
Right. Fair enough.
That's also another one of the conflicts of worldview that happened here. Yeah.
All right. Fair enough. And so let me ask you this. Why did they decide to, in support of the Ammons, or despite the fact that the Ammons didn't want their support, and because the sheriff didn't realize his constitutional role, why did they decide? Mm-hmm. Why did they go? Why did they look around? Was it they just basically like, we need to take over some? We need to basically take something back from the federal government to show our power? And they just sort of decided on this refuge because it was sort of the most defensible ground, and they were more, I guess, you know, better trained to deal with that in the woods than to go drive down to, I don't know, to some federal building, you know, Social Security Administration building or something. I mean, why was that basically it?
So, well, first of all, I mean, they were doing it within the county. They were also operating, obviously, in a pretty improvisatory way, guided by feelings, you know,
right,
that they saw as religious. But in terms of the strategy, that refuge is really key to that region. It's a marshland out in the desert. So it's also like the source of kind of, it's where the water pools, which is obviously incredibly important for any agriculture and also for all animal life. It's the source of life in the region. But I mean, that's not how they were thinking. They were thinking at the refuge, in particular, and its role. The Hammond family had a lot of conflicts with the refuge earlier on in the 90s. The conflicts they were in trouble for now were with the BLM, but the BLM didn't have that kind of facility. Ammon actually had never been to the refuge before he occupied it. But Ryan Payne, the militia leader who was his kind of partner in this, did go out and check it out and, you know, discovered that it had a lot of, met a lot of their logistical needs for something like this. They wanted to do a kind of occupation. They were inspired by the Occupy movement, but of course, being like big Second Amendment people, they're going to bring their guns because they thought the idea that you could just get zip tied and taken away from a protest was unacceptable to them. So a refuge, because of the amount of, you know, the budgetary limitations of so many of our federal agencies, especially when it comes to environmental protection, they rely a lot on volunteers. So they have great bunkhouse facilities for volunteers to come out and do work, which they saw and like, this is a great place to bunk down. Whoever will come out and join us. It was also 30, 40 miles from town. So outside of town, but also readily, you know, it allowed them, it worked as a guerrilla base, you know, it allowed them to move from there into town to do propaganda and then shelter at night out there. So they were, far out of town. They had a big there's a big fire tower that could see who was coming, but also it just provided a lot of facilities for them to host people.
So,
and it was January, so it was winter, and that was really important. You know, it's very cold there.
Okay. So that was important insofar as, strategically, it was easier for them because who's going to camp out and wait us out type of thing.
Yeah. And also for like getting people to come if they weren't going to be cold. Right. Yeah. And then the other thing is that they knew that county, you know, that county is the size of Massachusetts and it has 7,000 people in it. And there's four deputies in the county at that time. So they also knew that like whatever they're going to do, they're going to do there, because the amount of people that they could bring just through their horizontal, you know, Facebook right. platforms.
They could get 1% of the people in that county, basically 70 people they could have up there, yeah. Essentially. Okay.
And they could immediately challenge like the federal sovereignty and local sovereignty in the region just like that. Yeah. And they did.
So basically, I mean, what happens while they're up there? I remember watching the videos. I mean, they were live streaming this on Facebook, I guess it was, or maybe it was on Twitter. I can't remember. I remember people were sending
Facebook
them,
and YouTube. They use it.
People were sending them all sorts of like sex paraphernalia in the guise of being supplies, just to watch them having to pull out, you know, like a big dildo. And that was
the snacks.
Yeah, that was funny. I mean, social media obviously plays a huge role for them because they're able to sort of contact people and find their supporters across the country. What else happens up there that implicates the story later? I mean, obviously, there's one casualty which happened at the end of the standoff, basically. In some respects, marked it, Lavoie Finicum. But what happened during there that ends up really implicating stuff later?
In terms of the trials, or in terms of just like what how this story like resonates?
Yeah, I would say
resonates.
I mean,
situation.
Obviously the trial, narrowly, you know, things narrowly implicated in the context of the trial. But I'm saying, you know, were there any things that happened there? Because obviously, Ammon Bundy has recanted, I guess. Was there stuff that happened there that changed their perspective, or was it all the sort of the fallout that did?
I wouldn't say Ammon has recanted. His federal land stance is exactly the same, but he has renounced. He was really a militia person, and he's renounced that a certain sector of that patriot movement that has gone whole hog for Trump, and particularly in relation to the rhetoric around immigrants and refugees, which Ammon doesn't support. He's a super Mormon libertarian, and so his views on borders are not the views of nativist Trumpites. And also he sees a lot of the sort of rhetoric coming from like Trumpite militia people as being, you know, I mean, he called it fascist. So that's the source of that break. He also learned a lot in prison, I think, about he was in a private prison for a long time. I think that changed some of his perspectives. By the time he got out of there or from that prison, he was advocating for the abolition of the prison system, which is not something people were expecting.
Right.
And the replacement of it with a system of like restitution and reconciliation, which I don't know if he's done anything about that since he's gotten out of prison. But in terms of what happened out there, you know, I mean, it became the whole thing. It was so tense. And yet also for a long time, nothing was happening. They had a press conference every day, right? They staged media events. They were pretty good at doing that. You know, they cut a fence line to show that they were, you know, fighting federal tyranny. They had the whole issue with the artifacts of the tribe that turned into a big issue right towards the end that Lavoie Finicum, who was one of their leadership, who was the one casualty of the occupation, got very involved in, tried to use as a method to bring the tribe into the occupation in some kind of alliance, which is unsurprisingly did not work, especially since to the tribe, the idea of even handling the artifacts that were stored on the refuge and that were at the center of Finicum's reach outs to the tribe, was both an offense and also a dangerous thing to do. You just don't touch things and mess with things that are, that were handled or made by the dead.
In terms of just luck, right?
In terms of luck, or you're basically messing with the energy of the person who made that thing, is the idea, basically, to put it too simplistically, really. But an element, basically, of their power stays with the thing they made. And if you mess with that, it sets up a bad relationship with other aspects of that person. I mean, it's going to mess with your health. Yeah.
And malheur actually means bad luck, essentially, in French, yes? Or?
It means bad luck or misfortune, which none of the Bundyites seemed to know. It seems like I was often the person informing them that that was the name of the place.
Wow.
They'd occupied another thing that they didn't know about. And then there was also the role of the militia people who didn't join Ammon, who felt that he'd hijacked their thing with their rally for the Hammonds on January 2nd, but also wanted to play an important role. At one point, even coming out in full tactical gear to hijack Ammon's press conference and surround themselves with guys with long guns and actually say, we're playing a very significant role, though what the role they were playing was never exactly clear. Though that created some of the most famous images of the occupation are of these militia guys who weren't part of the occupation guarding their leaders out there saying, we're playing a very significant role. So there's a lot of comic moments like that, including with all the snacks and video misses from out there. And also, like, the tension in the county, though, began to build and build. And there's a lot of concern that it was going to explode into something pretty horrible and violent.
Did they have support in the context of the county? I mean, did they have support, measurable support anywhere?
They had support there, but not of the degree they believed. But they definitely had support. People were coming out there and bringing them food every day. And they were getting more attention. I don't think they didn't seem to be getting support from the established ranching community at all, but maybe from smaller ranchers who don't have as much access to federal land. And also from folks in town. It's a really depressed area. It used to be the wealthiest per capita income county in Oregon. Now it's by far the poorest, mainly due to like changes in how the forest is being used there, which is also the northern part of the county is pine forest. So they got some traction with, you know, people, disaffected people there, but it never seems to have been anywhere near half the county. Ammon believed it was everybody, or that everybody who was against him worked for the federal government. That does not seem to have been true, but it was definitely dividing the county, and there was starting to be fear that, it's also a very heavily armed area.
So
everybody's armed out there. So there was fear that that could, who knows what would happen if people started shooting at each other. I mean, beyond just even the federal government going in and arresting them, is that at that point, the FBI was just playing a waiting game, waiting for them to be in a position where they could, you know,
Right.
Take out the leadership, which is what they did.
All right. So looking back on all of this, like, where does this fit in? I mean, are we looking at a phenomena that has never left us, or one that is resurgent, or what? Like, I mean, this disposition towards the federal government, it seems to me, is something that just continually raises its head in one form or another. And largely, I guess the story with these guys is it's sort of almost unbeknownst to them as to what the roots of this are, right? Like all of the all of the legal precepts that they're basing their views on, that the sheriff is the key element, you know, the most powerful, law enforcement or government official that exists, is something that grew out of a theory that basically grew out of, I would imagine, on some level, like chasing down runaway slaves or chasing, you know, like some measure of relationship to maintaining slavery or the vestiges of slavery. What contextualize this phenomena for us, and what does it say about the era we're living in?
Well, again, yeah, I think that we see it in what I really saw in the occupation itself, right, is it made this figure, this complex image of our now, I would call it, thinking of like the now as being like where the past and the present combine to form an intertwined picture, right? And certainly that occupation, again, in the way that they were seeking their way out of, you know, actual economic and social malaise in the West, through this reenactment of, you know, the heyday of the second wave of manifest destiny and settlement, which is also the Jim Crow era and the era of the end of Reconstruction and the era of the doubling down on white supremacy and Western settlement, is something that speaks to American history across the decades since the 19th century, periodically. Whenever you have a push towards more movements of social liberation, you get this kind of backlash, right? That has to locate itself in some kind of historical period. There's a lot of how they talk, as extreme as they seem, there's a lot of how they talk that just reminded me of everything that came out of Ronald Reagan's mouth growing up, you know?
Right.
A lot of it, you know? Ronald Reagan talked openly about, government assistance programs as being the federal plantation. If you remember that rhetoric, that people still use, right? That's all coded in. That's just pure Jim Crow rhetoric, right? And it's still circulating in so much of our political discourse, often poorly understood by the people who are using it, but not poorly understood by people who are hearing it, you know? And that makes so impossible so many conversations, you know, including ones that maybe, you know, could be very useful to have. I don't think it's possible to have conversations about different kinds of intertwined sovereignty and, say, land management involving local, state, and federal sovereignty if people coming in with this anti-federal rhetoric are just channeling all this horrible history without knowing it. You know, how do you have a conversation when that history is not being acknowledged, when your states' rights rhetoric is states' rights rhetoric, is Confederate rhetoric? And,
So how
I think that just leads to the whole.
Well, I don't want to interrupt you, but I'm curious.
Mm-hmm.
The concept of states' rights, right? I mean, just to use a sort of the broadest sort of measure of this, was almost exclusively developed, and to the extent that it was used in other. So let's say forums or in regards to other issues, was simply to further edify the idea that you can't come in, federal government, and tell us how to treat our black people. Is basically right. What our slaves or our now freed slaves. I mean, it was. I imagine, you know, early on, there was a notion, you know, maybe when we're talking about the 13 colonies of like, hey, it's not fair that you get resources that we don't, or that you want some of the the value that we get because we have crabbing, you know, we have access to, you know, like whatever. Like I imagine there was
or seaports or stuff. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. There was an era where sort of for the states, the geography created certain value that they wanted to make sure they weren't having to give up because maybe there was some, you know, difficulty associated with it. Like, you know, it was hard to build these docks, or perhaps there is, you know, well, we've been founded by a group of people and we don't want, you know, we want polygamy, you know, or whatever it is. But what's left? I mean, what's left today in this era for those type of arguments if you strip out the sort of the coding there? Like, honestly, like, what does Rhode Island want with its sovereignty because of what's going on in Massachusetts?
Well, I think that, first of all, like, the states' rights rhetoric is, you know, the legacy that you're mapping there seems absolutely true to me, and that's what makes it, like, as a position, one that's like not an argument that goes anywhere but to a standoff, right?
But where do
at
they,
the same
what,
time, I think it's also
argument?
Part of
what do they believe? Like, if they like when you told them, like, hey guys, do you realize like this was just about slavery, and they go, oh my gosh, had no idea. Darn.
Well, they say that it's you know, that it's about federal tyranny, blah, blah, blah. Right. And that's about, they go into an argument that local people know that, you know, the ones who are the most articulate would go into an argument about how local people know how best how to manage their affairs and, you know, bureaucrats in Washington shouldn't be managing it, blah, 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 the usual kind of Reagan stuff. Right. You know, and I think that where those arguments have legitimacy are about like local versus big power structures, right? That, you know, having local people involved in the decisions that, you know, affect them makes sense, right?
Yes.
And federal structures that make innovative room for local people to kind of direct the operations in collaboration, as actually it has been going on in Harney County, unbeknownst to the occupiers at the refuge, who wouldn't know anything about that because none of them were from there or knew anything about the place, have been going on for about 15 years with local people basically getting to operate federal sovereignty collaboratively by consensus in terms of new policies putting down on federal land. Like that kind of stuff, that kind of conversation seems super legitimate to me. But how do you get to a place where you can have a conversation that's just about those practical things, about land management and about different relationships to the land and about coming to some agreement, when you have this rhetoric that's full of this horrible history that's being denied? I think it's incredibly difficult, and nothing happens partly because of that horrible history. But, you know, it's also, of course, it's been mobilized super cynically by the corporate libertarian right as part of the, it's like they don't mean for states to actually be more powerful. They like states because states are weak, and they like local governments are weak.
That's the amazing thing about
this. All bullshit.
That's the amazing thing about this is like anybody who's lived in a small locality knows that the corruption there is far more naked in many respects than it is in a more bureaucratic state. A, and then B, the whole point, theoretically, if you genuinely buy into this notion, which I think is legitimate, like you want people on the ground to understand the unique circumstances that exist in a community so that any type of federal law or assistance or whatever can be changed, you know, there's flexibility to meet the needs of that area. But how do you establish a principle beyond that? Like the idea that you could come in into a non-place where you're not a local and offer anything in that context other than you should work with the feds is ridiculous. It undercuts the exact point, right? I mean, it's like, it's almost, I don't know. It's almost, there's a quality of like, sort of like, you know, education reform and educator in this argument that I think is legit, but then you sort of step out of like, hey, wait a second. The whole point is they know this area. You don't. So beyond saying that there should be some type of partnership, you've got nothing to offer these people.
Well, I mean, that blatant hypocrisy drove people in Harney County bananas, as you can imagine. Like, you guys don't know anything. You're coming in here to represent us. A lot of the talk of people in the county is like, you don't speak for us. You don't know anything. You don't have a clue. Get out of here. And, you know, the irony of that was really obvious. And also, I think you see in that, too, I mean, to go back to where we started with Teresa's quote about Jason, you see, like, the violence of abstractions and of living by abstractions that give you good feelings, right? So they come with these abstract ideas about localism to impose them on a locality that they don't know, because it makes them feel like their lives are full of meaning and purpose, right? They're saving America. And we see in that the violence of that underlies that kind of pure abstract thinking, right? And the absurdity of it.
That is.
And, you know, I mean, I think that.
Go ahead.
And then that's all happening within this larger context of so many of our public institutions and public lives, public spaces and public spheres and things like unions and being eviscerated and replaced with these privatized public spheres of the internet, which obviously also, like, this whole thing wouldn't have happened without Ammon being able to organize this flock of fleeting sovereignty, right, to come impose its abstractions on this place, wouldn't have happened without all those social changes and different forms of privatization.
I think
that have undermined all levels of power.
Yeah, I think that that dynamic of abstractions being dangerous and then particularly hypocritical when that abstraction is that local uber alles, and you're not from that area, misses the point. But it's a fascinating story. Shadowlands, Fear and Freedom at the Oregon Standoff. Anthony McCann, we will put a link to your book at majority.fm. It is available tomorrow everywhere. Thanks so much for your time today. I really appreciate it.
Thank you so much. Thanks for the time and thanks for the attention. And thanks for the conversation.
My pleasure. Thank you. All right, folks. Fascinating stuff.
Yeah.
And this notion of, like, you know, how much of on the various things that we talk about on any given day deal with a people who have essentially inherited these abstractions without any sense of the historical context from which they came, which gave them birth and meaning. And, like, I've found just across the board, even in stuff that is non-political, like the idea of, like, people just thinking that there is nothing to symbolism or nothing inherent in ideas or images or whatnot. And the problem is that if everybody was completely ignorant, then maybe it would just be a bad idea, right? But the problem is that there's the same idea, which I have said on this program, and I think now there's data that shows this in terms of, like, protests and whatnot. All you need is about 5 to 15% of any given population to make change. And to cause problems, obviously the number goes smaller. And so when you have people who adopt rhetoric and they don't understand what the foundations of that rhetoric are, understand there are people who do know what that rhetoric means. They do know what the lineage comes from, and they build upon that. I mean, that's, on some level, that is a story that's happening in Portland this past weekend, right? Where there was clashes between some of the Patriot, you know, some Proud Boys and that ilk, and Antifa folks, and obviously most of the media attention has been some people who were engaged in black box tactics, attacking this guy who writes for Quillette. And frankly, I'd never heard of the guy. I haven't seen enough footage or reporting on this, like, what was the basis of this? The right would have you believe that Antifa was attacking journalists. But as far as I could tell, there was a ton of journalists around watching that attack. Now, I don't think that that guy looked a lot more beat up than he should have. I don't think there. I certainly don't condone violence, not in that context. You know, people milkshake. They shouldn't, and I think you can get ticketed for that. And I mean actual milkshakes. There's some question that I think there was an attempt to
Posobiec's
sort of
been stirring some stuff about cement.
Supposedly there's cement in it. Now, my experience with cement is not quite like that. You would be able to get away with that, but
there's been some skepticism expressed, let's say that.
Yeah.
I reminded all of my Antifa super soldiers not to drink the wrong milkshake by mistake.
There you go.
It's going to be murder on your insides.
But the bottom line is, like, you know, there's a lot of people out there who are just sort of hanging on to sort of outer concentric circles of ideas that are founded and are structured on really, really bad and oppressive ideas. And they may or may not know it, but and they may or may not know that they're helping promote these ideas, right? I mean, and you see it. I will talk about, you know, I interviewed Caleb Kane again and did a longer interview with him. And he's that kid who sort of fell into that wormhole. It started with Stefan Molyneux. And then by the time he started climbing out of it, he was, I can't remember what he called it, a race realist or something to that effect. And which is, I guess, like white supremacist adjacent. And
he's a white nationalist.
And you start to climb down a hole and it leads you there. Because once you accept one premise, I mean, this is the case with anything, right? I mean, both positive and negative. If I can somehow find that I could actually jog 1 mile, then maybe it's possible I could jog 2 miles. Like the point is that human beings, constantly are recreating baselines for themselves. And if you get yourself to the point where it's like, hey, you know, just the reality is that race, you know, you have IQ distinctions between race and IQ actually means something beyond how you do on the IQ test. Then the next step is easier to take and the next step is easier to take. And that's the whole danger of these ideas. I mean, we see this. We see people take down, buildings. Now, these ideas are also obviously a function and they're generated within contexts, historical and material contexts. And some of the people are subject to these contexts and some of them are just like receiving the ideas and passing them on. And then when they run into people who are in the right context and under the right political scenarios, that's when these ideas get really problematic. Right? I mean, if Ammon Bundy's just sitting in his house and not doing anything about it, just talking about the ideas, fine. But they float around, they hit the right person who is within a certain context that makes it problematic, and that's when you start having problems.
Yeah, Marx famously hated ideology and never referred to himself as a Marxist, even though Marxism is arguably not an ideology in and of itself. It is a framework for understanding capitalism.
Well, he and Marx and I share that same thing.
Hi, Marx. Hello.
But he had the advantage of just saying that, like, I'm Marx and people just assume he drops the ists.
Yeah.
He actually, we talked about this, he endorsed this laborite program in France, which is interesting because everybody always talks about the critique of the Gotha program, which is basically his version of saying something analogous to social democracy will be insufficient in a capitalist context. But then conversely, he embraced this French worker party and said, and the program he outlined at that time was all like, equalized wages, 8-hour day, and power labor unions, total social democratic program. And he said, you know, basically the people who opposed him in doing this, like, basically, like, yeah, I would not, like, you know, don't attach yourselves to my name because you're idiots.
There you go. In other words, he had a concept of the dum-dum left before.
Honestly, oh, I don't want to take it there, but that was pretty much what he was talking
you
about.
You should read what he said about Bakunin.
Dum-dum left. Yeah. All right. Just a reminder, this program relies on your support. You can become a member by going to jointhemajorityreport.com. When you do, folks, you support this program for just pennies a day. And we give you, in return, extra content virtually every day. Virtually every day. Almost every day that we do the show. This week, we're going to be off on July 4th. And then we're going to have a shortened show on Friday that will be pre-recorded, I believe. Because everybody goes out and barbecues except for me, apparently. And
I'll be on Twitter.
I'll be on Twitter.
Monitoring things. You're wrong.
You can become a member by going to jointhemajorityreport.com. Also, don't forget justcoffee.coop, fair trade coffee, tea, or chocolate. Use the coupon code MAJORITY, get 10% off. And it's always free shipping. So check that out. And when you become a member, we also cut out the ads. So if you want to know, like, how, for instance, you get today's special New Yorker deal, and you're a member, you just look in your member feeds podcast description, and you will see the deals. So you get the deals without the chitty chat. So become a member today. Join the majorityreport.com. One more thing. We have a big announcement to make in the next week. And I sort of spilt the beans on that startup podcast with Destiny and Dan. We're rolling out something new.
Oh, this is great.
I think it's...
This has literally been something that you've been wanting to do for years.
Something I wanted to do for a long time because I've always, like, it's something that I wanted to hear.
Right.
And I just assume that everybody else does too. But they probably, I don't know. Maybe everybody else does. Maybe they won't. But we'll give you more details in the next couple of days. But stay tuned. Today is Monday. Tomorrow is Tuesday. Tuesday is the Michael Brooks Show day. If you're not aware of that, Michael, what is going to be on it?
Tomorrow, we are going to be talking about reclaiming the future, organizing for a post-capitalist world, and the Joe Biden time warp. With Malaika Jabali and in the commentary. And then the Anthony Fontano, who I've been buddies with for a while online, host of the Needle Drop, is going to join us. And we're going to talk about he might interrogate my
We were going to have him on the Majority Report.
You're going to have him on.
Huh?
Cool.
I was going to have him on the Antifada. Oh,
I just got him scooped.
No scarcity, guys. Be like Andrew Yang.
There's enough of him to go around. Yeah, like,
everybody can have time with the Needle Drop on all the podcast platforms.
Unless you have food stamps.
Unless you have food stamps, then you can't speak to him, or you'll choose whether you talk to him or you feed yourself. So anyways, we're going to be talking about reggae and 90s hip-hop till today. We're also both followed by the @Lula official account, so we might talk about that a little bit. Looking forward to it. 7 o'clock. On the Michael Brooks Show YouTube channel, patreon.com/TMBS.
Jamie?
This week on the Antifada, in our free episode from Wednesday, we had a wide-ranging conversation with Chad Vigorous, a.k.a. Pretty Bad Lefty, from twitter.com, about white people music, race, socialism, class, and more. And in our bonus episode that dropped for our patrons on Friday, we interrogate Chad Vigorous's somewhat hot take that he would rather have communism with some racism than perfectly woke diversity capitalism. So check it out.
It's a very Chad Vigorous take.
Indeed. It's also, it's just a good problematic, shall we say. Also, this week we're running Prolit Cult as our main episode on Wednesday. So if you're interested in hearing AP Andy talk about the new season of Black Mirror, as well as UFOs, the paranormal, the parasocial, and the parapolitical, check it out. Also, just a little note about me. I'm going away to commie camp tomorrow, so I will not be here for rest of the week. It's in an undisclosed location in the Pacific Northwest.
Charge.
Hopefully I don't run into any Bundy types when I'm there.
There you go.
Do you remember that guy who challenged Chris Christie to a sumo wrestling match? Do you remember that?
Sumo wrestling
match? He was at the Bundy Ranch. He was one of the occupiers, and he got literally into a diaper and challenged Chris Christie to a sumo wrestling match. And I was reminded of how this movement fit into all of the great political movements of our history.
Apparently, speaking of Joe Biden, we were just talking, Jesse Jackson just basically went on and said he's been on the wrong side of history in terms of civil rights. I can't help.
On the same day that Simone Sanders said that he was modeling his idea after the Rainbow Coalition, Jesse Jackson said it was the opposite of that?
It appears Simone Sanders is regularly a little bit behind the rest of other parts of the Biden campaign.
Cycle, like her, she is like always a couple of... I'm starting to wonder if Simone Sanders is still committed to the Bernie Sanders revolution.
Yeah, literary hangover. Check out the most recent episode on Nathaniel Hawthorne's The Blithedale Romance, where he makes fun of the utopian socialists, sort of pre-Marx socialists of America that he was kind of a part of. And then later this week, I'm recording with my co-host Chris, Rutger Bregman's Utopia for Realists. We're going to talk about UBI. We'll probably talk about a lot about Yang Gang there too, and his work week and his other some of his other proposals. But basically, it's going to be a UBI thing. Is UBI a Trojan horse or is it a universal strike fund? We're going to get to the bottom of it once. And for
Bregman
all.
Came out. It was in favor of a UBI, but not as a. Me, not as an either or.
I think he has a more left UBI. Yeah,
he's an enhancement, not a cut. Yeah, I mean, I think we need.
He's
to
a
just
genuine
come up
liberal
with,
leftist.
We need to come up with some shorthand for describing like UBI as an add-on or add or subtraction UBI, basically.
Left UBI, right UBI.
That's how I think about it.
Sacrilege. All right, folks. See you in the fun half. Left is best. Jamie and I may have a disagreement.
Yeah, you can't just say whatever you want about people just because you're rich.
I have an absolute right to mock them on YouTube.
He's up there buggy whipping like he's the boss.
I am not your employer.
You know, I'm tired of the negativity.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to upset you. You're nervous, you're a little bit upset, you're riled up.
Yeah, maybe you should rethink your defense of that, you fucking idiots.
We're just going to get rid of you.
All right.
But dude.
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 You want to smoke this joint?
Yes.
Do you feel like you are a dinosaur?
Some good shit.
Exactly. I'm happy now.
It's a win-win.
It's a win-win-win.
Hell yeah.
Now listen to me. 2, 3, 4, 5 times. 847-906-501-457. 2, 38, 56, 27. 1/2, 5/8, 3.9 billion.
Wow.
He's the ultimate math nerd, don't you see?
Why don't you get a real job instead of spewing vitriol and hatred, you left-wing Limbaugh?
Everybody's taking their dumb juice today.
Come on, Sammy.
Dance, dance, dance.
Ooh. Grandpa.
I had my first post-coital scene with a woman. I'm hoping to add more moves to my repertoire. All I have is the dip and the swirl.
Fine, we can double dip.
Yes, this is a perfect moment.
No.
Wait, what?
You make under $1 million a year. You're scum. You're nothing.
Excuse me? Fuck you. You fucking liberal elite. I think you belong in jail.
Thank you for saying that, Sam. You're a horrible, despicable person.
All right, gonna take a quick break. I want to take a moment to talk to some of the libertarians out there. Take whatever vehicle you want to drive to the library. What you're talking about is jibber jab.
Classic. I'm feeling more chill already.
Good. Donald Trump can kiss all of our asses.
Hey, Sam. Hey, Andy. You guys ready to do some evil?
Hitler was such an idiot.
I think I might be a Nazi.
Agree.
No.
Death to America.
Do.
Yes.
Wow.
Wow, that's weird.
No way!
Unbelievable. This guy's got a really good hook.
Throw our hands up.
Ooh.
Wow.
But Sam, I gotta get off.
No worries. Let's. I want to just flesh this out a little bit. I mean, look, it's a free speech issue. If you don't like me,
hey, shut up.
Thank you for calling into the Majority Report. Sam will be with you shortly.